I'll join the meeting.
So hello guys, continuing with our pointer discussion. Now we come to strings, right? So on your Dropbox, you can just open the folder on June 3rd. June 3rd is strings folder. Just select the folder and you will have the programs already ready for you. So let me just zoom in. Okay. Right. So just two programs were remaining the other day for pointer manipulation. And I just first start with that particular program. Of course, you must have already understood the concept by now, but just a quick revision. Right. So we are defining something as const int int max as 3, right? Of course, not a very good way of declaring. This becomes a global variable, right? So max gets a global variable. So I'm defining an array having 3 elements, right? Because my max size is 3 here. And integer I and star ptr. So star ptr is a pointer variable, right? A pointer variable is something that holds an address, and the address will be containing a data type of type integer. That is the meaning of a pointer address. So what here I'm doing, I'm giving pointer ptr is equal to var. Var is nothing but my array. I can also declare this as this one, right? Both are same, or I can even declare this because var is an array. I can again declare this as same. So all the three basically are the same declaration. Why? Because whenever you are declaring something as a var, which is an array, by default the base address will be passed, right? So let us now just comment these two lines and we will see the output later on. Now what I'm doing, I'm going from I equal to 0 to I less than max. That means I'm going to I less than 3 and I plus plus, and I'm just printing the value and the address, fine. So let me just run the code. So now you can see the address is 284, 288 and 292, right? Because what happens in this particular for loop, I am printing the address and value. And if you can see, I am incrementing the PTR always, right? So when the address is incremented, right? So our base address in this case was 284. When the base address is incremented, how does the increment happen? Increment happens by the size of the data type. In this case, the size was int. So it basically incremented by 4 bytes, as we have already seen. And then we are doing star PTR. Star PTR is nothing but the content at that address. So 10, 100 and 200 comes out. Just for your convenience, now let us make this integer as a long double. So I am just replacing integer by long double. And let me just do a complete match. Right, so now every integer is replaced here by long double, fine. So let me just check the, okay, so I missed out, L, this will be LU. Let me just check the data type. Oh, address, okay, some issue is coming. Let me just check for long double. Let me just go to the previous code on pointers. I'm just missing the data type. Okay, so long double is, okay, should be percent u only. So back to this, let me just bring it back to int once again and just check the output. Okay, for int the output is coming perfect. Okay, now let me just try to change this to long double. Now what is the issue that is coming? Long double I PTR, and what I'm doing, this is I. Okay, this should be actually U. This should be U, and this again should be U. I think that is the missing thing. Okay, let me just check this out. Let me make this I as integer I, and I less than this. This becomes D and this becomes D. I think it should work now. 256, 268. Yeah, address is incrementing by 12. 256, 268, and 280. And value at var 0. Okay, let me just check why this is not coming. So this is star PTR. And this is, this should actually come. Maybe some issue with my GCC, or this should actually come now. So the fact of the matter is, if we just undo everything and keep the int and all, so this is how the array basically works, right? So when you increment an array, it will increment by the size of the array. So you can see the output, it is 284, 288, and 292. And similarly, the another program is the same program, but just I'm decrementing the value, right? So in this case, you can see I'm using this particular thing, ampersand var max minus 1. So what was max? Max was 3 in this case. So this pointer basically is now going till the last element. Why I'm doing max minus 1? Because in array, the indexing starts at 0. When the indexing starts at 0, you basically go till max minus 1, right? Same code. So just let me clear the screen and run the code. So you can see 292, 288, and 284. Percent LF. Okay, just let me check in the previous code then, percent LF. That is just a format specifier that you can just try. Right now, probably I'm not remembering it. Long int, what is the percent format specifier? So now we begin something interesting, which is strings in C, right? So basically, in C, you don't have direct support for strings. In Java and Python, you have a direct support, but in C, you don't have a direct support for strings. String is nothing but a character array. So if you remember, let me just go to the board. So when you declare something character, so let's say character, if you're having something called, let's say we have a blood group, right? So a given character will only store just a single character, right? So let me write again, character, let's say, blood group is equal to A, or something like I can say character, if I want to store the gender, I can say gender is equal to M, right? It can be M or F, but at a time only a single character will be there, right? Now what is the difference between a character versus a string, right? String basically is a set of characters, right? So we can have, let's say X is a string, right? But for example, a mobile is a character, is a string. X is a character, mobile is a string, in this way. So now how does character arrays work in C, right? So whenever you want to declare mobile, so let's say you want to say something of character country. So one method is to assign, let's say, 10 memory spaces, and then let's say you declare India, right? So if you see in memory, India takes 5 characters, right? And I'm giving 10 spaces, just similar to what we did in integer declaration. So in integer, we basically used to declare an integer array of something like 100, and we can take 10 inputs. So some of the memory location go waste, right? Another way of declaring is, so for example, let's say in this particular case, what I'm doing, I'm defining hash define size. It is a better method than declaring global, right? So when we say size as 10, so what are we doing here? We are defining a character string 1, which is of size, right? Size means basically 10. So internally, the compiler will replace this by 10, fine? And I'm defining string 2 as a pointer, right? So now what happens in this particular case? Let me just show you how this is represented in the memory. So let me just go to the next page. So I am writing here, character star string 2 is equal to hello. Right? So now you may see here, since I'm declaring it as a pointer, so as you know, because I'm putting a star here, this becomes a pointer. And you can see that there is no bracket here, right? There is no bracket here. That is missing. So what happens? Let me just show you how hello is represented in the memory. So let me have a pen color. So just let me write H-E-L-L-O. Right? It will be still represented as an array. But one important thing that you remember with strings is that all the strings are internally ended by a special character known as slash zero. Now you may say that slash zero is two characters, but technically it's just a single character. Just like, you know, slash n is treated as a single character, a special character, right? And now let me just change the pen color to, let's say, black. So when I'm declaring a character array, string two, right? I am basically pointing to the base address, right? So this star string 2, basically it's a base address. So let us assume the base address is 2000, right? So basically the string starts at 2000. Every string takes 1 byte of space, right? It takes 1 byte of space. So what happens? The next location will be 2001, 2002, 2003, 2004, and 2005, right? So this is how any string that you declare ends with slash zero. This is the most important point, and you need not write it here also, right? There is no need to write in this fashion. The compiler, when it compiles, it automatically assigns a slash zero towards the end of every string, right? Now what happens here is, like, when I call a function, see, I'm calling a function copy one, right? I'm calling a function copy one and I'm passing both the strings. So my string one is not defined and I'm passing string two, which contains hello, right? So now let us see what happens. And then I'm basically, what I'm doing, I'm again printing string one, right? See, again, string, basically, if you see, this is a string array. So when I'm passing string one, it means the base address will be passed. And string true, obviously, it's a pointer, so it's an address already. So I am passing the address of both the string. Fine. Now let us come to the function copy one. So what is copy one doing? I am copying this string one into S1. I am copying string two into S2. Fine. So what this function will do, copy S2 to S1 using array notation. Now let me just come to this board. So what is happening here is, I have a copy one function which takes S1 and S2 as input. And what it will do, it will copy S2 to S1, right? So basically, this string will get copied to S1. Now let us see how it happens. So see how the loop runs is, integer I is equal to 0, right? And see, since both are character arrays. So you can see whenever I'm declaring a pointer, it is as equivalent as an array. Both of them are arrays. So integer I is equal to 0. S1 of I is equal to S2 of I is not equal to slash 0. Now I will just explain what happens here. Right? So let me just take an example. We have a string 2 hello and we have a string 1 of size 10. Right? How does this happen in the memory? Let me just do a next here. So I have a string 1. Yeah, string 1 is of size this. Let me again write it here. I have a string 1. The size is 10, right? So when I'm having a size 10, that means 10 memory locations. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So you can count, we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? So these are 10 memory locations. And then we have string 2, which is a pointer and which basically contains hello. So if you see in the code, I am not specifying the size of this particular array. So this is more optimal representation because the compiler automatically counts hello, which has 5 characters, and then gives a slash 0 as the sixth character. So see how it will be represented. And in the last, it will be a slash 0. Okay. So this is for the help of the compiler to know what is the last string. And now let us see the loop, what is happening in copy 1. It says integer I is equal to 0, right? And we are evaluating an expression here, right? Basically, it says since we want to copy the string 2 into string 1. So, right, see, this is the equivalent. So, in the case when I is equal to 0, what will happen? S2 of 0 is equal to S1 of 0, right? And which is not equal to slash 0. Basically, I will tell you what happens here. This is a very nicely written code. Basically, if I want to copy this to here, what will I need to do? Let me just change the pen color. So basically, what I need to do is traverse this string, right? I need to traverse this string from H, E, L, L, O. How do I know whether it's the end of the string? I basically should reach slash 0. That is the end of the string. Till the end of the string, I need to copy each and every character to the string 1. So what I do here in the first step when I is 0, right? When I is 0, what I do? S1 of 0 is equal to S2 of 0. What is S2 of 0? Because when I'm passing function, this is S2 and this is S1. What is S2 of 0? S2 of 0 is H. That gets copied here. Yeah, Ashish, any doubt? So S2 of I gets copied to S1 of I, and basically, which is not equal to slash 0. Obviously, it is not equal because the current character is H. Then what we do? I plus plus. So basically, there is no body required. So we just give a blank semicolon. Fine. Then I plus plus. Then what happens in I plus plus? I becomes 1. So what is S2 of 1? So let me again write here 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. What is S2 of 1? Which is E. Now it is equal to S1 of 1. That is E. Then similarly L. Then L. Then 0. Then finally what will happen? S2 of 5, right? So S2 of 5 is slash 0, right? So slash 0 will also be equal to S1 of 5. That means this will also become slash 0, right? So what will happen? Slash 0 is equal to slash 0, right? So basically what happens? S1 of 5 is equal to slash 0, right? So S1 of 5 basically is equal to slash 0. And what we are checking? While slash 0 is not equal to slash 0, right? So we are saying slash 0 is not equal to slash 0. right? So this is a false statement, right? Slash 0 is equal to slash 0, right? Since this is a false statement, we just complete this particular loop and we return to the place where the function was called. Now see one thing, we did not return anything. It was a void pointer, right? The function return type was a void. Why? Because we directly operated using the pointers. Now when you see the output of string 1, now what is string 1? What the compiler does, it keeps on reading the string till it encounters a slash 0. So it will print hello. Slash 0 is not printed on the screen physically. It will just print the string. So now let us see. Okay, some issue. Okay, some issue. Probably I have a space in the file name. That is why it's coming. Let me just change the file names. It should not have happened, but let me just change the file name, I guess. Close all. I think space was the issue, right? So avoid spaces in this. So when I run this code, so you can see string 1 now gets hello by the same logic which I explained you on this particular sheet, right? So strings are nothing but character arrays. They take 1 byte of memory. Integer takes 4 byte, character takes 1 byte. All the string basically are ended by slash 0. Right, so they are always ended by slash 0 in the end, indicating the string termination. Now there is another function, let us say character array string 3 and string 4. Right, now I'm again passing string 3 and string 4. Now you can see string 4 is an array notation, right? So since it's an array notation, it automatically determines the size. So we have goodbye, so goodbye is 4 plus 3 7 and one space. So total 8 characters it is using, and now I am copying this string 4 to string 3, right? Because string 4 is already goodbye, I need to copy it to string 3. Now let us see how this works. Again, the same condition, because I am passing the name of the strings, which are nothing but arrays, I am collecting them as a star string, right? Because S1 and S2 contain the base address. And from the base address, if you append a star, you basically get the content here. Now again, what I'm doing, I'm just looping through the string, right? It is just the same logic like this. This was an array notation, and now this is directly a pointer notation. Again, what we are doing, we are having two strings, S1 and S2, right? If I tell you this example, so what will be star of S2, right? So let me just take a new sheet. Let me change the pen color. So we have string 3, which is initially blank, and string 4 is goodbye. Right? So basically, what happens here when we are passing both of them to copy2 function, copy2, and we are passing S3 and S4. We are passing the base address of both the arrays. And since we are passing the base address, let's say this is 2000 and this is, let's say, 3000. In the loop, what we are doing? In the loop, we are just accessing the content of that particular memory location, right? So if I see, the memory representation of good will be like this, 2000, 2001, 2002. 2003, the space is 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007, and in the end, the compiler adds a slash 0, which also takes a memory location, which is 2008. From 3000, it is a blank location, right? And this is S4, right? Pointing to basically the base address. So now when I do S4, right, basically this is S2 in this representation. It's okay, we can have it S4 also. So let me do one thing. Make this as S2. This is S2. Right? Let me just erase this. This is S2. So this is S2 and this is S1, right? So what I am doing, I am saying here in the loop, content of S2 should be equal to content of S1, right? So what is the content at? So what is the star at 2000? Star at 2000 is G, right? Star at 2000 is G. It is copied to content of S1, right? So this is basically, in our case, this is S1. So what will be the place? So G will be copied here, right? And so on. It just increments both of them. S11, S++, S1 and plus plus S2. So what happens when you do plus plus S2? You basically reach the location 2001. And what happens when you reach S++ plus plus S1? You reach the location 3001. So what gets copied? Now, O gets copied, right? Goodbye. The O gets copied in location 3001, right? And what we are checking, that we are not reaching till slash 0. Of course, you will only reach slash 0 when you copy every string from right to left and go up till slash 0. So just another approach. So you can just run the code once again. You can see hello and goodbye, right? So basically, there are just two methods of copying string. So any string operation that happens, that actually will check whether the string end is reached or not. And the ending of a string is determined by this special character known as slash zero. As you can see, it's a character itself. So you can see we have a single quote enclosed in it. Fine. So this was the first basic string program. I just took some time to explain it because, you know, the rest of the string concept remained the same. Right, so let us take a break for 5 minutes and then we will be back at 12:30. Right, 12:32. So let's take a break. Doubts are welcome.
Sir, why we are using constant in copy one?
Yeah, const, as we saw in yesterday's lecture. I clicked the same link again. Okay, const here. So as you can see, what are we declaring const here? So we are declaring S1, right? And what was S1 containing? S1 contained the base address of the string, right? So we did not want anybody to modify the location of our original string, right? So we had copy one here. So copy one was having string one, and you can see we had S2. S2 basically contained hello, right? So we want that string two should be copied to string one, fine. So both string one and string two must have been in some particular memory location, right? So when we say these both addresses are constant, we don't want any other part of the program to modify the base address of string one and string two. Now let me just, so why do we use const here? Let me just go to our next page and let me keep the pen color as black. So what happens in this particular case is we have string one, string two, and let's say we have string three, right? String one is something at a base address 2000, right? And string 2 is at a base address 3000. Let's say we have a new function here, right? Which takes some elements, and what it is doing, it is assigning string 1 a new base address. Let's say it is assigning, there is a new character called country, like this, right? So we can have character star country is equal to, let's say, India. So in this particular case, what will happen, and another function can possibly modify, right? So basically we will have another location called country. Let us say the base address is 4000. So if I do such a kind of assignment, the string 1 now will contain the base address of country. So string 1 basically will not have the base address of 2000, but it will have a base address of 4000. So what will happen? Then string 1 will also point to the content India and not to the content that we copied. So when we do a const here, that means we are saying that the content of address S1 cannot be modified by any other variable, right? Accidentally or intentionally. So that is why we make it const. Just we saw it in the previous lecture yesterday. Other doubts? So string programs, although there are 13 programs, you know, all of them are mostly you can directly execute and just check, because, you know, we just include the library C type. Okay, we will just be back in a minute or two. Okay, class, so these all programs from 2 to 13 are really easy. They are nothing but the display of some inbuilt functions in C that you can use. But for some of them, I will just explain how the concept actually works, right? So these are called black box function. At least I call them black box function because you can directly use it. But actually, from a programming point of view, at least you should know what is the logic that is happening behind. Right. So basically, if you can see here, so now we are doing string manipulation and we have to include the library called ctype.h. So it defines various functions for doing string manipulation. So now let us just directly execute the code and you will understand what is happening here. Right. So many printfs are there. So let me just run the code. So you can see according to is lower, right? So basically is lower is a function. Right, and in the is lower, I am passing a single character. Right, I am passing a single character, and basically, this is a ternary operator. So, let me just explain what is a ternary operator. I hope it must have been done, but just a quick revision. So, in ternary operator, what happens is you have something like this. So, let's say if A greater than B. Right, this is the condition, right? This gets executed if true and if false. So you check for a condition, right? If the condition is true, execute this part, if the condition is false, execute this particular part, right? So this is just a very small shorthand for if and else. Rarely people use, but in this case it is used. So I can just tell you, let's say if A is equal to 5 and B is equal to 6. So if I write if A is greater than B, colon, right? Print, let's say India. Right? Sorry, this will be a question mark. Else, print, let's say New Zealand. So A greater than B. So what is 5 greater than 6, which is false. Since it is false, it will basically print this particular statement. That is what ternary operator does for you. Right? So now let us go to the next. Now what happens here? So you can see P, we know. So what does lowercase? So any such functions, what you can do, you can just directly Google. So is lower, right? So you can get on W3 schools and there are various websites, right? You can get. So what does it says? It says the is lower method returns true if all the characters are in lowercase, otherwise false, right? So what happens here? I think this is not for C. Okay, this is Python actually, because these languages is lower in C. Right. So as you can see, function is lower takes a single argument in the form of an integer and returns the value of this. Okay, this is basically prototyping. So what happens is lower basically checks whether this character is a lowercase or a uppercase. If it is a lowercase, it returns true. If it is not in a lowercase, it returns false. So you can see small p is a lowercase character. So basically this must have returned true. So it basically prints is a lowercase character, right? Now capital P. So capital P is not lower. So what happens after the colon, the false part prints. P is not a, and then the common string lowercase character. Right. So similarly, phi is not a lowercase letter because of course phi is a number, and then it is checking for exclamation. Exclamation again, it's a special character, right? So basically this is lower checks for the strings A to Z, capital A to Z, that's it. Similarly, same is the is upper function. Now what happens? Capital D is an uppercase, the rest all are not uppercase function. So you can see the functions, their names are so logical that you can actually understand. Now we have functions like two upper and two lower. So what does two upper does? Two upper basically does is like takes any string and converts it into a uppercase. So you can see small u is converted to a uppercase u, right? Numbers, they actually don't change because they are not characters. So they remain as it is. Special symbol remain as it is. And basically this L basically to lowercase because we have a function called to lower, which will convert this into a lowercase, right? So these are all inbuilt functions. So just let me let you know what is the internal logic. Okay, let me just check the program this. So similarly, you have another set of code. You can just directly execute this from the Dropbox. So there is something called as is space function, right? So basically what it does is whether the given character is a space character or a not a space character, right? So what happens here, all the programming language define few characters as a white space character, right? Why they use the term white space? Because let's say I write A space B, right? Let's say I write A space B, this space. Why it is known as white space? Because on the screen, it will look like a white only. Right, normally the backgrounds are white, right? So that is known as a white space character. So programming language also take tab as a white space character. You can use the tab key on your keyboard to check, right? A tab B, this is again a white space character, right? So you can see slash T. So horizontal tab, which is known as slash T, right? Because it horizontally indents, is a white space character. So new line again is a white space character, because when you have A and B, this basically is a new line, again a white space because you cannot see the new line, right? And then this is how you can just check. For example, you also have the punctuation character, right? Punctuation means whether it's a semicolon. So for example, Y is not a punctuation character. Again, hash is not a punctuation, right? Because hash is not a apostrophe, single quotes, all these are punctuation characters. Full stop is a punctuation character. Then we also have a function sprint. So all these inbuilt function you can actually Google. If you have a programming assignment in CS112, they will actually mention whether can you use inbuilt functions or you cannot use inbuilt functions, right? So these are just, you know, self-executing programs. For the sake of completeness, I'm teaching you all these. Okay, so again, now let us come back to another piece of code. Okay, this is the reverse. Okay, this is for the reverse logic. We will take this program a bit later. Okay, so there is a function called getchar in C, right? Getchar, as the name specifies, takes a single character at a time, right? The getchar function takes a single character at a time. Now, what if you want to input a sentence in C, right? Because C only has the character type, character sentence size, and the size is defined here as 80. So what if you want to take a sentence like India is my country in the input, right? So one of the method is like basically, okay, this puts, right? So this you must have seen for the first time. Puts basically is nothing but a printf statement. But without the U, it's just a printf statement usually used for strings. You can actually use straight away the printf. You can just forget puts. But you can see online many implementations are there where they make use of puts, right? So what happens in basically the while statement? So you can see in while, what happens? You will keep on taking the string character by character till the user does not press an enter key. So whenever you press an enter key, the compiler gets slash n as the input, and then it will stop. And what I'm doing, see, I'm having a character array. I am reading each and every character, character by character, each and every input by the user. And I'm continuing that till I don't encounter slash n. And every character, I am assigning it to the sentence variable, and I'm doing I++. So technically what is happening here is, so we have a getchar function which takes one character at a time, right? And we have a sentence array which is of size 80, right? So when I insert India, right? So basically what happens in this case is, the sentence array, let's say it began at a memory location 2000. So getchar basically will take the input I first, then I take the input I. What it does is like, then I do I++, right? What was I basically? I is just a counter. And sentence, as we know, is an array. What will happen when I do I++? I basically move from the location 2000 to 2001. Then what we do, character array, the getchar again takes the next character. Let us say the next character was character n, right? So now you can see that n, character n is not equal to slash n. Obviously slash n is a new line. So what it does, it just assigns it to the next character. Then again, I do I++, I move to the location 2002. From 2002, I can get the next character. Let's say that was D. I get it D. Then again 2003 will be I, 2004 will be A. And now let's say I press enter. Now when I press enter, getchar will have a value slash n. Slash n is not equal to slash n is a false statement. So basically I terminate the while loop, right? Now what happens? Because every string needs to be added a slash zero at the end. So what I'm doing here, I am adding first a slash n. Okay, slash n will not be there. We just end a slash zero. Because the moment you enter slash n, the while loop is terminated, the sentence is not incremented, and then you get the last position. where you enter slash 0, the special character, which is at 2005. And then you just puts basically is just printf. You can directly use this. So in this, you directly write the variable name and then you get the code. Okay, so just let me enter a line of text. Why did it execute? It should ask for this. So enter a line of text. So let me write India is my country. See, till the time I'm not giving a enter, that is slash n, it is allowing me to enter the characters. So when I press enter, the line entered is India is my country, right? So puts is nothing but basically, if you can see, this is just a printf, right? And it basically prompts for the user to enter a string, right? So just a shorthand, you can achieve the same thing by using printf and getting the character by character, right? Enter an integer and a double, so 124.54.68. Okay, class, in this basically this is string formatting. Basically, if you want to have the output in some ordered fashion, like right align or left align, that you mostly use with Microsoft Word and all. So I will just show you a very small example, right? So in this we have taken two variables, integer x and double y. Fine. So the program basically asks you to enter an integer and a double value, right? And now you can just see I'm defining a character array, and in this I'm using sprintf instead of a printf statement. So what does basically sprintf do? So in printf, what happens, you're directly outputting everything on the screen, right? You are not storing the output of printf into any character or into any variable, right? So as you can see, printf basically is used to print the data on the standard output, which is usually the computer monitor. And in printf, you can actually use a sprintf also. Now in sprintf, you can see format and arguments is same like the printf statement, but along with it, you also have a character pointer here, right? So it is just like a printf. Instead of displaying the formatted string on the formatted output, it stores the formatted data in a string pointed by the character pointed, right? So instead of displaying, it is basically storing that particular output in a variable. So see what happens here. I am doing integer %6d. Now what does %6d means? That means I am reserving 6 boxes for displaying the output. I will explain you what do I mean by 6 boxes. And then I'm doing percentage 7.2f, right? So this again is a formatting thing. 0.2f, I will just explain you what happens here. So let me just execute the code again. So let me say the integer is 15 and the float is 68.52, right? So it says the formatted output stored in S is, right? So now you can see when I'm displaying the integer, I am having some space previous to this. Again, when I'm having double, I am having some space and then I am having this particular values. Let me just execute it again. If I am in 15 and 62.5247, right? Now let us see how the output compiles. Since we are having integer as percentage 6D, that means I am giving 6 boxes to integer. So let me just go to the next slide. So what I'm doing here, I am having something of percentage 6D. So 6D means I will have 6 boxes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I am reserving 6 boxes in the memory, right? And what was my number here? My number was 15. 15 will only take 2 boxes. but I need to begin it from the right hand side. So I will write 15 like this. These four boxes will remain empty. So you can see if I count here, right? So let me just copy this into Notepad. Right, so 1, 2, 3, 4, right? The initial space is basically in this one, right? So if I remove this particular space, you will actually have, see, this has an additional space here. So one space plus six more boxes, right? That is why it is coming in this fashion. Now for double, what I'm saying, I am doing seven spaces for the main number, one for the dot and two for the decimal. So you can see when I entered 62.5847, how it will do? Let me just come back here. So we had seven spaces for the main number, one space for the dot and two space for the decimal. So this is how it will be. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? So we have seven spaces for the main number, seven boxes, one space for the dot and two space for the decimal portion, right? Two for the decimal. So when I entered something called 62.5847, what did the compiler basically do? The compiler said, okay, your 62 I will do from the right align, and since you have reserved only two boxes, right, 0.2 for the decimal point, I will ignore your rest of the output 5847 and just place here 58. Now a doubt will be, for example, what if I enter a number which is bigger than 7 digits? Then in this case, basically it overwrites this. So let me just execute the code. So let's say I enter an integer which is above 6 digit. Let me run the code. Integer is, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 7, 8, okay, and let's say the double is, right, which is again more than 7 digits, right? So you can see now the right alignment is overridden, right? Because our number was actually bigger than the space allocated, then in that case it overrides it, fine. So this is another example. So now you can see whatever was basically displayed is now stored in the character pointer S, right? You can see this S basically is a character, right? Because it is a size is 80, so that means it is basically pointing to the base address, right? So the formatted output stored in the array is, the formatted output stored in the array is this. So you can see whatever basically was appearing on the string, basically this particular thing I am storing in the character S. So if you anytime want that whatever you are printing on the screen should be stored in a character array, you can use sprintf, right? So you can assume like S is for store printf, right? That is how it works. So class, I think for today's class, I think this is enough. The rest of the string copy and all these functions we will see in the next class, right? Doubts are welcome. Others, if you don't have doubts, can leave the session.
So can you go in the last code?
Okay, yes.
So what is the use of that percent s slash n in 26 line?
Okay.
Like for part.
Yeah, so basically if you see this particular thing, s represents a character, right? And in this particular string, we were holding two variables, x and y, right? Initially, they were basically integer and double, fine. But now what is the data type of S? The S has a data type character, right? Character has to be percent C, but since this is a character array, the format specifier is percentage S. And this slash n is nothing but just to, you know, display the output into a new line. So let's say if I don't use slash n, so just let me check the output once again. So let's say the integer is 15 and 1.33. So you can see basically we lose the slash n, right? If you see, why did the double come on the next line? Because when we entered double, we actually pressed an enter. So that just came on the next line. that is just for formatting, nothing else. You can see for the same output, if I run the code again, and if I give 15 and 1.33. So it is just basically this slash n basically is just putting an enter after 15. And this slash n is just putting an enter after 1.33. That's it. Okay, class, so I think that's it for today. We will be going on this string copy from string 7. We will be going on Tuesday. Fine. So I'm muting this. Stop sharing.